For me, you know, I, as someone who teaches it, I know there are a lot of definitions on the term diversity, but for me, diversity is understanding that differences exist, and then with that understanding, embracing those things that can bring value from a diversity or a different standpoint in order to make an organization better.
I was about 8 years old. I remember it was my friend Jay and I. We were always reading these adventure books. I remember my first one was like this little guy with an atom, and you got trapped in the atom, and you had to find your way out of the atom. And we saved up our money, and we bought the red box set for D&D. And we're flipping through it, and I was going to run a game for us because I was sort of the storyteller. And even as we flipped through, I saw in the book there were never really anyone that was like us. It was a little disappointing, but of course we're eight, so it's like, it happens. We'll go on. And so we started running games based off of that.
My very first tabletop gaming experience ever was actually really terrible. To this day, I sometimes wonder why I still participate in tabletop gaming because of that experience that I had, because it was just so negative. But I think a part of it is that I was very young, and so was everyone else involved. And we weren't, you know, very sophisticated thinkers yet. And I think as I've sophisticated as a thinker, I've gone, oh, that was really terrible. But at the time, I was a kid, and I wanted to fit in. This was the only option that I had. And I was the only girl. So there was just this big chemical mix of things that kept me from just leaving. But what happened was I got together with a bunch of guys who I considered to be my friends from school. And we played a game of either 3.0 D&D. Yeah, it was 3.0 or 3.5, one or the other. And of course I knew what D&D was because I was in Nerd Spaces, even though I hadn't participated before. And I got the general gist of it. And I was actually really excited to play. I was like, oh, this is going to be a lot like what I do online. Yay. So we roll up our characters, and, you know, one guy is a barbarian, and another guy is a ranger. And the first thing that happens is that they insist that I play a drow because I have brown skin. And that makes sense. And looking back at that now, obviously that's really not a great thing. But I was like, okay, drows are kind of awesome. They're a matriarchal society. They eat people. Like, why not? I can be a drow. That sounds cool. Not really understanding, you know, a lot of the context of why this was even coming at me this way. The second thing that happened is they were like, you should play a sexy thief. And I was like, okay, what does the thief do? And they're like, she has two blades and she stabs things. And I was like, that sounds great. I love stabbing things. And so we began to play. And the very first thing that happened was that we walked into a dungeon. We were accosted by some sort of miasma or knockout gas. And my character woke up naked and alone in a cell without any of her equipment and no way out. And the entire point of that session was for the rest of the group to try to figure a way to get me out. And like, there was literally like actually no way for me to escape my prison on my own. And so this is a train wreck, right? I'm like, okay, you know, I don't know any better. Like, fine, whatever. This is kind of annoying. I'm not getting to do anything. I'm just sitting here. And then they come and they rescue me. And I'm like, that's great. Let's go kill some things with the daggers, right? That's what I signed up for. And we get maybe three or four more rooms in, and I shit you not, it happens again. In this same play session. Knocked out, stripped naked, no gear, stuck in a room with no doors, have to wait to be rescued. And that was my first tabletop gaming experience.
So I almost left role-playing games forever.
when I was about 9 years old, actually just 1 year after I started playing. I was the only girl in at the D&D party where I learned how to play D&D. Best birthday party concept ever, by the way. You all have 20th level characters and ice giants will keep attacking until you die. It was an awesome party. So the following year, again, I was the only girl. I was super into D&D and I went to camp. They had a D&D activity, which was like six boys ranging from 9 to 14 and me, a 9-year-old girl. And one of the other players decided that it would be funny to have their character rape my character. I did not know what they meant, but it was clear that it was bad, and I did not want it to happen. And there was a long argument about whether or not this could happen, and I actually ended up, the GM said, well, you two can fight, like have a fist fight, and whoever wins, wins. So I won the fight, but I sort of walked away going like, that thing, I don't really understand what it was. It was clearly bad, and I was clearly meant to be ashamed of it. And only the fact that I was willing to like punch a guy in the face sort of got me out of this sort of humiliating and you know, sexualized experience. I'm at 9 years old, right? I did not know what was going on. But I knew, and certainly afterwards, you know, when I went and looked it up in the dictionary, I was very upset. And you know, that's not often the kind of thing that we think about as a diversity problem. But there's a lot of research that shows that when a marginalized group is less than 25% of the representation, right, in a community, that they're always seen really as members of the marginalized group, not as people. And that can lead to all sorts of, you know, bullying and discrimination. And I think that this is one manifestation, right? If there had been three girls in the group and not just one, I'm not convinced that that kind of thing would have happened. My being a girl wouldn't have been as salient, and I'm not sure it would have been as socially acceptable to do.
My first D&D game was a con game at Dragon Con probably 15 years ago. I hadn't played D&D, and I've heard of, I'd seen the cartoon. That was about my exposure to D&D. So, you know, I'm like flipping through the book. I saw a picture. The woman kind of looked like Storm. I'm like, oh, that looks like a cool concept. So I make up what I find out later is a drow. Didn't know this at the time. I was like, oh, it's an elf. She's got dark skin and dark hair. Okay, cool. That sounds like good. I walk in, I describe my character walking into the tavern where the rest of the characters are sitting, and one of the characters slits my throat and the GM lets him. So I kind of left the table and did not come back to D&D for a long while. But yeah, so it's not always been perfect. I didn't go to cons for a long while because Dragon Con was a little, there were guys who were a little grabby, and I was not appreciative of that. So I didn't go to cons for a while.
Yeah, so I really like conventions. I go to a lot of conventions every year, up to 11 or 12 sometimes. So I'm very, very familiar with convention spaces. That being said, they are pretty fraught with a lot of sexual harassment issues and issues of representation. I won't name names, but some of the biggest conventions in our hobby, you know, I go to them every year, and there's one where on the exhibit floor, I've never not been sexually harassed. So you say it and it sounds really dire and you feel overwhelmed and you're like, well, how is it that bad? I don't hear this. It's because we get tired of talking about it, right? And it's just sort of like, we all know how it goes, but maybe everyone else doesn't.
I've heard too many stories of harassment. The microaggressions that happen are phenomenally hard. And just, I don't know, like I can't imagine a world where Gen Con has a place for me to exist happily and peacefully.
So my first Gen Con was not a pleasant experience. I actually have a little bit of a blog post about it, but primarily every year I've gone to Gen Con, I've always run games. It's sort of like what I like to do. And people would come and sit around the table. Some people would sort of look at me, then look that I may or may not be GMing, and then they would just walk away. Other people to the table and go, so when's the GM going to show up? Oh, you're GMing? Do you know anything about gaming? Or if I played in a game, someone would then like turn to me and say, so this is what a rule book looks like. I hope you're smart enough to understand what I'm about to tell you.
I wish I had more positive things to say to you, John. but I actually almost exclusively do not play games at conventions with people that I do not know anymore. And that is because, not once, not twice, but over and over again, when I sit down at convention tables with unknown quantities with strangers, things can just get weird and get bad, and people say terrible things, racist things, sexist things. And a lot of us, I think, go through this thing where when one of these incidents happened, we're just so shocked. We're not prepared to do anything about it besides kind of sit there stunned and unable to sort of battle with it. There are so many social conventions that keep us in our chairs, right? That it's really hard to say, hey, stop, you stop that right now. That's really terrible. Because there's four other people in the room and they're all like, well, there's nothing wrong with that, right? By the very point of them not saying anything before you say anything, you're like, oh, I'm the only one that's upset with this. And this is even in, you know, fairly progressive gaming spaces that this has happened. So it's a really big challenge. And I don't know that my solution is the best solution because it's more insularness. But continuing to expose myself to gaming tables where I'm not having fun, because the whole point of gaming is fun, does not make sense to me anymore.
You want to know the truth? I don't go to most other game conventions anymore. I do double exposure events, not only because it's geographically convenient, but also because I find that unless I'm doing a Christicon, which we do at some other conventions, I'm a little worried about the types of players that I'm going to encounter, because you can encounter really awesome people. But then sometimes, you know, there can be problems at the table, depending on who's there. And so encountering strangers at a gaming table, especially if you're going to play something that can verge on sensitive topics, can be a little unnerving.
When I went to Gen Con for the first time in 2011, I literally, like, walked in the door at the convention center and, like, was like physically like stunned by the number of white people, like white dudes. I was like, whoa, like that is a lot of white dudes, right? And like, not in like a scared way, or just like kind of stunned. And like Marissa reminded me, she's like, we like, that's not what our local cam is like, you know. And I've gone to cam conventions for forever, right?
I have this game that I play that I still play to this day. Whenever I go in, I'll always look for someone else that's sort of at least a minority or a POC. And usually, it's a very sad game because it's usually me. If I'm lucky, I may see a few ladies that are also there, but very rarely do I see another person of color.
It is largely, or in my opinion, largely about economics. So, you know, when we talk about people coming to conventions, I mean, look, we're very lucky in some sense because this is my job, right? This is like what I do for a living. So, you know, does my business pay for me to come to Metatopia? Of course. Like, it pays for our plane ticket, pays for our hotel room if we needed to. The convention wants us here, so they're willing to, you know, help out with the hotel room or help out with travel, right? That's like a typical thing. When I talk to a convention about us coming out, at this point it's like, okay, cool, what are you going to do to help us out and make something happen? That's not what my Hispanic friends from Albuquerque have an opportunity to do. They haven't invested 5 years of their life into, like, the games industry just to get here. So, you know, we talk with people like, you should come to Metatopia. But they look at the cost of a plane ticket, and that's, you know, $400. And they look at the cost of a hotel room, and that's another $300. And they look at food, what that would cost, or, you know, getting from the airport to here. And pretty soon it's a $1,000 trip, which, if you're making okay money, is not a bad investment if you want to be a designer. If you're running a business, it's not a bad investment. But to just do it, right? Like, that requires a level of disposable income that makes this place not just whiter, not just more male, but also just, like, wealthier.
It is exceptionally difficult for me to attend a con because I'm a Sabbath observant Jew, right? So cons start on Friday, go till Sunday morning. For most of the con, I don't write, I don't spend money, I don't use electricity. So it becomes very difficult to participate in events as a full participant. And I've actually had people say to me things like, what are you even doing here, right? You can't do anything useful or meaningful. You can't play this game because you need to be writing, and you know, maybe you have workarounds, but they're not as good, and we don't want you to play with us. And I see that there are barriers like that for people from other groups, right? So we talk a lot about race and gender, but religion is a big one. Class is huge, right? Disability. I mean, I've been to game events, game design events that were not accessible for people in wheelchairs or for people who were visually handicapped. So it's sort of a miracle that we have as much diversity among game designers as we do, which is depressing because actually the numbers are terrible.
I'm really weird because I have a lot of positive experiences, but a lot of that is because I curate very carefully. And I will investigate a space before I go there and kind of try to feel out whether or not it's going to be a friendly space. That said, especially in game stores, I find there's a lot of resistance to treating me like a normal person. So there's a lot of like exoticization of the fact that I'm a woman and like, oh my gosh, there's a girl in the building. And I find that a very negative experience, because even though it seems like it would be positive, like people are being courteous and kind, what actually happens a lot of times is I feel kind of like I'm an exhibit in a museum and people want to stare at me and you know, instead of just taking me as a gamer, like they take me as sort of this external quantity that they don't know how to relate to, which like, I just like games. I just want to play games. Talk to me like I'm any other person who plays games with you.
You know, game stores are really important to our hobby, and right now they're fairly regressive spaces. To a game store and immediately know if I'm going to have a hard time. It's really easy because I will get something that I have termed internally as the nerd stare. And I am also a huge nerd, right? But I will walk into a game store and I can just feel like the chair swivel as a bunch of usually white cis male eyes turn and just sort of look at me. And it's, you know, whatever. People always look to see who's coming in the door. But then I get this look that's like, what are you doing here? Like, I get a look that like I'm an alien, basically. And I am intruding on someone else's space, even though it's totally my space too. And it always has been since I've been a kid. Almost every time that I've walked into a gaming store, I've gotten that nerd stare. And anytime that I have, I know that I'm going to have a hard time, that someone is going to try to explain to me what an RPG is, or they're going to assume that I'm there to look for my boyfriend, or that I am a fake nerd girl. Like, it just, the list goes on.
I've been in game stores where they actually have painted the walls, and sometimes the art can get objectifying, I suppose would be the right word, and you just look at that and that is the only thing that is feminine in the store. And that just, it doesn't make me want to go away, but it makes me feel more careful in that space of the other people there.
I was at an organized game day at a local store. I signed up for a game. I show up wearing a geeky t-shirt, and I sit down at the table with my dice. Halfway through the game, we took a break. And the men at the table then began to ask me what I played. In a very condescending, oh, do you know which dice to use kind of way. They don't know me, they don't know anything about me, it doesn't matter. They assumed that I knew nothing about RPGs. I don't know if they thought I just wandered in off the street, but it was incredibly insulting to be asked, oh, have you ever played an RPG? Oh, what kinds have you played? List for us the kinds of games you play and what you've played. By the end of the conversation, we had established that not only had I been playing longer than them, I played more games than them regularly, and I played more times per week, and I just shut that down, but I shouldn't have to do that. And it was really enraging.
If you're in Albuquerque and you wander into a game store, it's probably a little whiter than Albuquerque is on average, But it actually still has, like, you know, Hispanic people that go there because it's their local game store. That's, like, their local community. And I see the same thing in other cities that we go to. Like, they look like the cities to some degree. But they are always a little whiter and much more male. I mean, that I think is even more pronounced. Game stores tend to be places where we see mostly men. And of course, one of the big things for that, one of the big reasons for that is they don't always look like super safe places, right? You go to a game store and they're like, oh yeah, all the games take place in the basement. And you go down to the basement and you're like, this looks like a murder shack, right? And you're like, why would anybody come here, let alone a young woman who's not sure if she knows anybody, right? Like, and so, yeah, we get that definite sense that, you know, these aren't always environments that are super fun and friendly. And I think about something like Jim Crocker stores, the Modern Myth stores in New York and Massachusetts. And Jim's here as a retailer for the convention. And like his stores, I walk in and I'm like, man, if I had a 13-year-old teenage daughter, I would drop her off here and be like, I will see you later, honey, because this place looks friendly and awesome and clean and rockin'. And I know that there are those stores all across the country, but more often than not, it's not exactly the friendliest environment.
But mostly the demographic there is dudes primarily. But I don't really go to those places because half the time, as a female, I usually feel uncomfortable or insulted. I'm like, well, I F this noise. I'm going to go elsewhere. Like, the demographic is not all weens anymore. And, you know, I need to get over that because it's like we want to play too. It's everyone's sandbox. Everyone should be able to play with the sand.
You know, I know there are a lot of social clubs that exist for like people, but again, I think the issue with that is that our world is so different, and from the standpoint of just supporting like people, I think you can become a target, right? We only like this sort of people. Our world is not made up of just this sort of people. And so I think you can get a negative reputation based on exclusion of people and not being inclusive. And two, I would think from a social aspect, you would want differences in the people who were a part of that club or organization.
Thinking about diversity as just about identity is a mistake, because you may be marginalized and you may have power, right? So the fact that I am, a Jewish woman, great. Those are marginalized identities within games. Doesn't change the fact that I actually practically have a lot of social and pragmatic authority and power that I can share with people who don't have as much power that I do. But when I look for people to share with, I ask myself, how hard is it going to be for them to get resources elsewhere? And that's where marginalized identities come in, right? So there are certainly dudes who are less powerful than I am, but they have more other choices than women in their same situation. So I look for ways to lower the pragmatic barriers to people from all backgrounds. We shouldn't just have an invisible norm for what it means to be a game designer, because then we're erasing the voices of so many people who could make games that we would love to play and that would express things that we don't yet know how to do with role-playing games, right? Like, I'm thinking about innovation in the field, not just what's fun for me.
This is not something for us to save or step in with some great, you know, problem-solving thing that's going to make it all better, because that's antithetical to solving the actual problem. But then what? If we can't do grand dramatic gestures, what can we do? I think that openness is the best thing we can do. I think things like the open game license, which we totally embrace with Fate, things that create the resources that let people create their own games with less friction, implicitly make it. Because one of the problems is there is a certain degree of friction and difficulty for getting your game out the door. It doesn't matter who you are. But for different people, there are different levels of friction. And if you can reduce friction at any level, then it will help everyone.
I think the biggest difference is that organizations who really embrace it and do it realize, I think, is just a boom in their creativity and innovation. Bringing different people into the mix actually helps an organization to see things differently, be that from a strategic direction, that they're looking to go, or, you know, when we're talking about products and services and you know, doing different things from that aspect, or just enriching the culture within the organization. Every organization has its own culture. And I think when you have a more diverse mix making up that culture or that organization, you're going to get some really good things as a result of that.
There are some designers sort of in my home circles and stuff who I hang out and talk with and that sort of thing too, but I've always, and they've certainly been encouraging, but I think that a lot has changed sort of recently in the community, especially online. Women, queer folk, people of color and stuff are able to come together and tell sort of uniquely their experiences and their stories and that sort of thing, and this ability to go, oh, me too, really matters. Because in my home group, a lot of the designers are like white, straight guys, which is fine. But they tell different stories because their lives are different. And just this encouragement to go, no, 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 this story that you have that's a little bit different from what you're used to hearing actually matters. And also other people have it too. So we should all tell these stories together has played a really big part. So yeah, I don't know if I actually would have come to something like Metatopia without outside encouragement from other people. It's really hard to say.
I absolutely think that the life experiences of designers from marginalized groups in games, without question, have an impact on the games that they make, we make. Right? But here's the catch, is I don't think that that impact is predictable. Right? So I don't think that... well, I have some part of my identity is marginalized, or I'm from a group that's marginalized, and therefore I'm going to write games that are full of empathy, compassion, and tolerance. Right? Or, well, you know, and therefore I'm going to write a game that involves violent retribution against the oppressor, right? People are idiosyncratic, and people are different. And the creative process takes both who we are, our life context, our experiences, our aspirations, and sort of shakes it all up. And it would take a much cleverer study than I could ever design, than anyone I think could ever design, to try to unpack how the alchemy that happens, that takes those influences and experiences and turns them into the games that people make.
Diversity is only ever good for the gaming community in a lot of different ways, but in this particular aspect, it means that we have more power to tell more kinds of stories with more nuance that are going to show more people that they have a place at the table and that their story can be told. So a perfect example is one of the games that I'm co-developing with Sarah Richardson and Marissa Kelly, Bluebeard's Bride, which is a feminine horror game in the tabletop space. As it turns out, it is the only feminine horror game in the tabletop space. As far as I know, and the research I've conducted, this has never really been done before. And I find that kind of ridiculous. Feminine horror is an amazing genre of horror. It's really interesting. It's really empowering. And it simply does not exist in our space yet. So I didn't set out to write this game because no one's ever done it before. I simply sat down and was like, what's interesting? What do I want to tell? And this is what came out authentically. And so I can only imagine all the other people who aren't game designers who have that same impetus, but don't actually have a way to get it out because there's no content that's going to address the stories that they want to tell. So we've seen a huge uptick, I think, in the indie space particularly, of games and game designers suddenly becoming conscious of this idea of diversity making games more awesome. And in the Kickstarter community specifically, you know, they have the setup of stretch goal writers who write additional material for a base game. And we've really sort of exploited that space to tell a bunch of little pieces of different stories from different places where we wouldn't normally see them as a collective. And that has been really cool.
To illustrate the phenomenal power of representation. As soon as I started, writing stories about things that women cared about, B, writing stories about women care about and getting other women to write stories about what women care about, and then three, prove that it could be financially viable through a Kickstarter. During the Kickstarter itself, I had four other people contact me to say, do you need more games? And some of them were like, are from around the world. And since then, I did a little contest during the course of it that was like, I didn't even know if it would work, but I figured, you know, if even one person does it, it's an extra game, right? That somebody will play and somebody's thinking about something different. And I didn't get a lot of responses, but for a very short contest for a radical different idea, I got like 10 games that were all phenomenal. And many of those people are going to be developing their games into full-time games. At this con alone, this last 72 hours, I've had 4 new people pitch projects to me. So it tells me, I mean, it's the most validating thing I think I might have ever been through, that it's like I raised a question that people are answering now, and that they all feel empowered to not just, they're going to design their games, whether I accept them into something or not, but that I have a way to help them conduit them into a publication or to something that's more formal or to sparring or to hook them up so that they can do it with each other. That's phenomenal.
Was really interested in Moira Turkington's Warbirds, and it got me thinking a little bit about the Cambodian genocide, because in my family, there are actually members of my family that were killed in that or who were greatly affected by it, that sort of thing. And I got to talking with Mo about it a little bit. She's like, you know, you should totally write a game. I'm like, well, I'd kind of intended on working on something anyways at some point. She's like, yeah, I can help you with it. I would totally be willing to publish it, that sort of thing, under Warbirds, because it certainly fits into the idea of telling untold stories from different perspectives and that sort of thing.
It's fascinating to me how many men are starting to come to Warbirds games where they realize they're only going to play women, where that was, 10 years ago, I couldn't have gotten 4 people to show up to a game. So there's this, it challenges the expectation that the default character in a game is going to be male or going to be white or going to be straight or going to be anything very specific. So that's one. Secondly, grounding it in history means we have a real world basis for this. This isn't just we're making up our fantasy world. We have always had representation in the world that just didn't get counted for, and it makes people look at it differently. It makes them understand their world slightly differently. Thirdly, and probably most importantly, I really fundamentally believe in the power of LARP and role-playing in general, but there's something specific for me and the way I engage with games with LARP and our ability to emotionally engage with different ideas and transform ourselves. I have seen people come into contact with games who have reevaluated their entire paradigms of the world based on those games.
So I think games like Night Witches are important. And that is because basically my whole life, I've had to fit myself into the white male narrative and see myself within that. So flip that around and to make a white male see themselves in a Soviet woman narrative, I think is a good exercise for everybody. There are things, particularly about the feminine perspective, that you're not gonna get unless you try to engage it directly until you try to embody it. And I think the key to games like that is actually in the design, right? You could design this game really well so that it delivers that experience in a genuine and authentic way, or you could not design it well and it could just be about all kinds of other things that aren't really based on this experience that you're aiming for. So I think this is where design becomes really important, and understanding its place in these contexts is also really important. If you want to communicate an idea or express a way of being, then it has to be baked into your game from the ground up. It can't just be like a wall of text at the front of your first page where it says, women in Soviet Russia do all these things and think all these things. You have to drive players to arrive there themselves.
I think it's exceptionally difficult for people to make games about something that's completely outside their experience. So, even if that experience is vicarious. So when I talk about vicarious experience, I actually mean the kinds of experiences that we have in fiction, the kinds of experiences that we have in games, the kind of experiences that we have in our imagination. Those are still experiences, and they still happen to us. They're still part of our lives, right? So to say, well, oh, that was a book you read, that's not part of your life experience. Well, it is, actually. And there's some interesting studies showing that, I talk about research a lot, there are some interesting studies showing that it's actually our memory doesn't encode real experiences and fictional experiences any differently. They're both just memories that we have. And we may know that one experience didn't happen to us and the other did, but it's that line is not always as clear as we might like.
Do you almost essentially like the elbow drop on it? Drop on his body, turn the back, to kind of crush
it. The first time that I heard of intentionally hiring someone who was diverse or bringing someone on board to an organization that I was a part of, I was a little taken aback by that. You know, I said, they specifically wanted an African-American man to fill a position in the organization, which was predominantly white. There were a handful of African-American and other ethnicities that were a part of the organization, but for this specific task, they felt that an African-American man would be the best fit for that role and were intentional in their hiring. Initially, I thought that was discriminatory because what if there was a white man who could do the job just as effectively? But I understood from the strategic perspective of where that organization wanted to go, the need to fill that position with the right person for the job, someone of color, and someone, of course, who had the skills and ability to do the job, would also grow the organization to be one that was more diverse. So it was intentional, and I think organizations today have to be intentional in how they're looking at bringing on board people who are different.
I started working on it, and then she poked me and was like, you should totally apply for this IGDN scholarship to go to Metatopia. I'm like, oh, here are all the long list of reasons why I can't go. And she's like, I don't care. And I went, I'm easily persuaded. So that's kind of how it happened. So I applied, and I'm thinking, oh, I can only go for part of the con. I have 50,000 other things to do. It's never going to happen, whatever. And then Mark emailed me and was like, yes, congratulations, you should come to the con. Like, oh, God, I guess I'm going. So that's how I ended up here. I'd heard about it in the past. I was always kind of interested, but it was always one of those, oh, maybe next year, maybe next year, maybe next year sort of things. But I guess this is next year.
A lot of the barrier for folks coming here is, of course, going to be cost. And a lot of people who are in underrepresented groups are going to have possibly going to be underrepresented because they may be disproportionately impacted by costs, right? And if you can get people here, then they're going to make those contacts. They're going to have people that they can talk to. They're going to be part of those communities. A lot of the scholarship members for IGDN eventually join IGDN, which is a big network of people who talk shop, right? And that's essential if you're trying to get something going. You need to be able to talk about the nitty-gritty, the sort of nuts and bolts of how do you do all of this stuff to get a book published or a board game or a card game actually finished and out.
We raised some money from the local community to do that. We put some money in. We partnered with some organizations. We were able to bring 4 designers here, but that's because we were going to pay for their ticket. We partnered with Metatopia. They helped us to cover the hotel room, right? Like, I mean, that's not like just sending people nice notes and asking them to come and telling them that it's worth their time. That's telling people, we think this is so much worth your time that we're going to pay your ticket, pay for your hotel room, and make sure that you have a strong network of support here. And that's, in my opinion, what brings them. It's not rocket science. It's like, hey, if I'm willing to pay your ticket, a huge barrier to entry just went away. But that's 4 people. That's not 4,000. Yeah.
I think as gamers, we have real challenges with saying no to bad actors. Because a lot of us, including me, come from backgrounds where we were outsiders. And we're very sensitive to pushing other people towards the outside of our spaces. We want to accept everybody. We want to welcome everybody. But that's actually really harmful to people who are vulnerable because they don't have the power to say no and push those bad actors out. So when a bad actor is identified, you have to do the right thing and you have to push them out of the space. And that's really hard for some people to deal with. And I get it. It's complicated. You can get it wrong. But as long as we allow them to continue to operate in these spaces, the most vulnerable people, will be the ones that are going to be the most affected, right? So you have to take that into account.
Because one of the things we talked about at Nerdly North, it's one of the cons run locally where I live, was the idea of inclusivity and being welcoming and how they're not necessarily, like they overlap, but they're not necessarily the same sort of thing, right? Like, you can try and be really inclusive without ever being welcoming, because sometimes being inclusive means that you're accepting elements that don't allow other people to be welcome. So in my case, what I expect, like a space that is welcoming to me is one that is generally respectful, and that generally, polices toxic behaviors without necessarily making judgments about people, right? Because I mean, people who behave in a toxic manner may or may not be doing so because they don't know any better, or they haven't been taught better, or because they're venting off other things that have happened to them. It's really hard to say, right? So, and I want a community that looks at behavior and say, these behaviors are not okay. If you can stop doing these behaviors, you are definitely welcome. But these behaviors are not. And I kind of like that idea a little bit better. It makes me think a little bit about diversity. Like, I was making the joke that everywhere I go is diverse because I'm queer, I'm like not white, and I'm a woman. Like, woo, I bring diversity everywhere I go. But what does that actually mean? Like, what exactly do you think is supposed to happen when I magically walk into a room, right? Like, I joke that, oh yeah, I'm totally awesome and everything is fantastic and perfect and wonderful, but I'm just like one person and I just have like, I'm just me. So when people flail around and go, diversity, we want more of it, I'm like, well, okay. But then what? Like, what do you want diversity because it's just a thing that you want and you want to ticky off a box going, we're totally diverse, and not really look at what that diversity might mean? Does diversity mean that you are policing toxic behavior so that people are coming out of their own volition? That sort of thing, right? So,
you know, diversities can have a tendency to just be the trendy term that people use or organizations or clubs use. We are diverse, but they really aren't, or they don't know what it means to be diverse. They don't understand the value that it can bring. So they have some type of initiative that they can say, you know, we're diverse, and take a couple pictures, do a PowerPoint training on it, and then 3 months later, you know, again, you see no difference in the workforce or the people who are a part of it. That does not bring about significant change, nor, I think, a deeper understanding and commitment to diversity. It's just, again, the trend of the moment. So, you know, again, they have to be committed to it being a part of the culture of the organization, of the club, of the group, whatever it is. And then the actions have to match that.
The first game we put out with Don't Rest Your Head, but the first large game we put out with Spear of the Century, and we made lots of first-time publisher mistakes with it, but one of the big ones was, boy, there were a lot of American straight white dudes in that book, and not much else art-wise. We had one prominent woman among the heroes and one among the villains and everything else. Straight white dude, straight white dude, straight white dude. Which, yeah, that's the trap a lot of folks writing pulp fall into, and we fell into it hard, and we got called on it, and that was difficult. You never like to hear that, but Fred especially stepped up and said, all right, well, then we need to do it better, and subsequent Spirit of the Century products have very strongly addressed that, and we then took that thinking and have rolled it forward into everything else we do. Now, we still suck at it. Our core is largely white dudes. We have many more women and less straight white dudes among our writing pool, but we are doing what we can. We are not speaking from a position of expertise by any stretch of the imagination.
One of the things that I feel like role-playing games lacks is a diversity of setting, a diversity of different perspectives. It's very kind of stuck in that Western European perspective. And so I wanted to create a game that highlighted a culture that's different than the typical medieval Western fantasy culture that gets put into role-playing games. What happened with how we came to live here is that I was really trying to do it in a respectful way, in a way that was, that would let people experience a culture that's different than theirs without feeling exploitative or feeling like it was appropriation. Obviously, as a white guy, there's going to be some appropriation involved. And after there was a bit of a stink online about another game that had been using Native American themes, I contacted some of the folks who had spoken up about that online, some Native American activists, talked to them about my game, and after sort of talking with them about it, I decided to pull it off the market and do some more consulting with people from the actual cultures, rather than just doing it all with like book research and my own experiences, to try to make that make it a better representation of what I was trying to do in the first place, which is have a culture other than the white American or white European culture in it. I still haven't managed to find somebody who's the right fit for the consulting on that, because I'm trying to be very careful about the specific tribes I'm consulting with, and finding folks who are members of those tribes also have an interest in the game sphere. It's it's a process, but I am confident that I'm going to be able to find somebody eventually to talk to. But I would feel much better about it re-releasing it if it wasn't just me, as the creator.
I feel like I have gotten really lucky in finding the indie tabletop community. Gaming aside, it's one of the most progressive sub-communities, at least in word, that I have encountered. And, you know, everyone's trying to figure out how to back it up with Deed. I'm sure that because of the way that gaming works as a culture, with basically a bunch of little islands not talking to each other and everyone being really insular, that there are many, many other places that haven't seen as much progress. But for our little part of the world, I think things are going much better, and we're at least having these conversations. And a lot of times, you know, this stuff takes iteration. You're not going to go, oh, I need to do this thing, and then just fix it and you're done. You're going to go, oh, this is problematic. We should think about ways to fix this. Let's try this. That failed. Let's try this a different way. That failed. Let's combine the two. Okay, now maybe we have something. And I think what a lot of people in the gaming space are afraid of is failing when they should be thinking about iteration. I feel like white allies in particular feel that it's really risky to get things wrong, because if they get things wrong once, they're like X-nayed off the list or something. But that's not actually how progress works. Progress works because we at least try these things, we see where they don't work, and then we try again. So I think we're getting a little bit better at that, but I think we all have to work really hard to support each other and continuing the iteration and not just throwing our hands up and walking away.
If a company or an organization really stands by that they are diverse and looking to be inclusive, if something happens, I think the public is more willing to forgive if that company does not shy away from dealing with the issue, right? Confronting it, talking about it, explaining what happened. If an apology is necessary, apologize, and then their actions again, working to ensure that it does not happen again. So I think those are some of the steps that can happen or need to happen if an incident were to arise and needed to be addressed from a diversity standpoint.
So with convention spaces, I always look to see how sophisticated their harassment policy is, because that simply indicates, like, have they even thought about this? And then the second thing that I look at is, if they have a harassment policy, do they follow up? Because every convention will have things go wrong. Every convention will have incidents. It's just people. That's how people work. And so what is really telling is what the convention does about it. A good harassment policy is useless if it's not enforced, if people are afraid of actually holding up the boundaries that they establish. And so I guarantee at every convention, something's going to go wrong and someone's going to do something wrong. What does the staff do? And if they don't uphold those policies, then I know that they don't really mean it, or they haven't really arrived at a place where they know how or desire to enforce these cultural norms that they are trying to establish.
I think it's really easy and pat to say, like, well, if it has a harassment policy, that's a good space. Or, You know, if you see a lot of white dudes, that's maybe not such a great space, because that's just, they're not necessarily sensitive to those issues or whatever. But the reality is that, like, you know, different spaces are threatening in different ways, and different spaces are rewarding in different ways. And they're like, you know, I've been up to Seattle to some cons up there, and they are great about gender stuff. Like, you feel, like, super confident that people's, like, preferred pronouns are going to be used, that, you know, like, people talk about, you know, trans issues or just feminist issues in general with, like, a real sensitivity and thoughtfulness. Difference in that sense, in the sense of gender and gender presentation, is really celebrated. They're almost all white people. Like, to the last one, right? And so the theory of sort of anti-racist moves within that space is just limited, right? And their ignorance, I use that word as neutrally as possible, like, literally, like, they just don't know, right? It's not that they're willfully, you know, out to create a space that's not friendly, or even that it's not friendly. It's just, like, it's clear when you walk in the room, like, all right, this is not a, like, real thoughtful space about race, right? I think as a person of color, especially as a Latino, where, like, I present as white, you know, people think I'm a white dude and never ask any questions about it most of the time. You know, I think that what has proved to me to be the most welcoming environments is always environments that are structured productively for everybody. So it's not so much like my particular issues are honored, because, like, I'm used to my issues kind of, like, going back and forth, right? I mean, I went to graduate school at a school of public policy that never talked about the drug war. Right, like, for me, that's just, like, madness. Like, how could you have a school of public policy and not talk about, like, one of the single biggest issues to my community, period, right? Period, across the board. Not, like, one of the single biggest issues of the modern era, or, like single biggest issues in my community's history, present day, future, is, like, how we're going to handle drugs. And we just ignore it, right? And that's incredibly not good. That's, like, incredibly the wrong atmosphere for me. But that's, like, a school of public policy. Jesus, like, That should be, like, you know, welcome. I mean, we have, like, you know, codes of conduct. They're all about protecting people. But you can't protect people from, like, bad ideas, right? That's just how it is. But you come to Metatopia, and you've got this sense that, like, okay, people are going to have their playtests, and that's their time. And people are going to have focus groups, and I'm going to participate, and I'm going to be a player, and that's going to be productive. And, you know, sometimes you're going to get a dude in one playtest that just talks to everybody else, and we just try to do our best to limit that, and it can be a really productive space. And it feels to me like that structure is what I'm looking for. Because all those other things that we try to shorthand for, ultimately, I think, end up being sort of, not false, but, like, limited, right?
Demographics for game stores and game conventions have been very white male for a really long time. And I do see that changing. There are a lot more women, certainly. Last time I went to Gen Con, which was the year before last, the proportion of women to men seemed to have increased a lot, even since the early 2000s when I had started going to Gen Con in Indianapolis. One of my friends asked me to sort of look around and estimate, and I think I said something like 40%, and that was pretty close to the actual numbers that Gen Con released. So that's up from probably 10% when I first started going, right? And I do see more people of color, but I think that's one area where it still hasn't, you know, that hasn't picked up like female participation has.
This is one of the big blind spots of the communities that we have the metrics of people who come to these conventions, and we can look around, and it's, and you get certain fantastic cues, like last night when one of the women's events happened, you could actually look around and suddenly notice that the number of people hanging around had dropped drastically. Like, the population had shifted because the number had gone. And that's a fantastic sign when that happens. But conventions are also self-selecting. And so I don't know how much of a reflection they are of the community as a whole. You get more of a sense of that from individual game stores. And this convention, while I love it, it is probably a better representation, or at least more the representation that I'm happy to see, than you'll find in anywhere else. But that's also because Avi has taken steps to, and Vinny and the whole crew. I'll keep saying Avi because she brought me coffee this morning, but I'm not trying to rule anyone else out. Have taken steps to make sure that it's a friendly, positive environment. And that's not super common yet.
There may be a few more pictures of maybe someone of color, or maybe more women than there used to be in the old days. But it's not enough. It's not a true representation of where we are. And I started my company because I wanted to do something, but also when my daughter arrived and I want her to embrace gaming the way that I have. And I thought that I don't want my daughter to see the games that I had to see growing up and try to overcome those obstacles to fall in love with the way that I have.
Our world has changed and grown, and I think you know that it doesn't even matter anymore what the industry is or the organization is. Our world is very different, and the differences that exist in people today, I think, bring value to any type of organization. Organizations that fail to see that and understand that, again, run the risk of growing stagnant and irrelevant in our world today. Diversity means difference and change and growth, innovation and creation, or creativity, I guess is a better word for it. But without it, again, you're doing the same thing with the same people and you become irrelevant.
I think that there are a lot of things that we can fix and that we need to fix, right? But in a way, the pervasiveness of the problems says to me that there's hope, because every single person, I think, can reach out and make a change, because the problem is everywhere. So wherever you look, there's a chance for you to do something to make it better. Thank you.